In this video, we are going to see about the subroutines in 8085, how the subroutine is handled in microprocessor 8085. So first, let us see what is a subroutine. A subroutine is similar to our functions in higher level languages, where you write the main program and then you write separate the function separately outside the main program. Then you call the functions within the main program in order to execute it. The same thing here also. Only thing is, we keep everything in the main memory, that is random access memory. And the main program will be separate, and then you will write the subroutines in separate memory locations, and then we'll call the subroutines, and the subroutine will be executed, and then the values will be sent to the main program. So a subroutine is a group of instructions separate from the main program that will be called repeatedly in different locations of the program to perform a function. First of all, why we go for a subroutine? Suppose we want to do some display function, okay, or some delay routine. So the delay routine or display functions may be used for 5 or 6 times in a program. Imagine, even in a small program, you may want to display some output repeatedly, depending upon the conditions. So in that case, what happens if you write the display, the related instructions again and again in many part of the main program? Instead, if you write only one routine so that the display will be done and you call it from the main program repeatedly, the same routine will be executed. So not only that, say for example, binomial coefficient. If you execute a binomial coefficient, the equation is n factorial divided by r factorial into n minus r factorial. For n factorial, you will write the same set of coding. Only thing is, argument will be n. Then for r factorial also, you will find the factorial value only. The only thing is, the value of r is different. Same way n minus r. So 3 times you have to write the same set of codings in the main program in order to achieve the result. Instead, since the execution of factorial is same, you can put it as a separate function and you call it 3 times with the different parameters. First time you call it with the n factorial, second time you call it with r factorial, third time you call it with n minus r factorial. So if you want to do some repeated operations in many part of the program, then it is better to go for a function or subroutines where you write it once, but you call it from the main program repeatedly. In this case, the size of the main program also will be reduced. Instead of writing the same set of instructions again and again and again, you can reduce the size by writing the subroutines and calling it whenever it is needed. So a subroutine is a group of instructions separate from the main program. So that is the main idea. You should not keep the subroutine, should not be kept within the main program. It should be separate. And from the main program, you have to call the subroutine. And it will be called repeatedly in different locations of the program to perform a function. Rather than repeat the same instruction several times, that's what I have said now, they can be grouped into a subroutine that is called from the different locations. In assembly language, a subroutine can exist anywhere in the code. However, it is customary to place the subroutines separately from the main program. Suppose imagine this is a main program. This is a main program. Now here you have the, you are calling the subroutine where it is defined here from 1200H. This is whatever given here is a memory. Okay, memory locations. So here it is defined. Subroutine is defined, and what are all comes that will be defined here. Then when there is a return statement, it will return to the main program immediately next to the calling. So here, in this location 78H, the call to this memory location is taking place. Call to the subroutine is taking place. So what you do, call 0012 is nothing but this is the memory location. So when a call is executed immediately, the sequence, the program counter value will be replaced with 1200. That is, this is a memory location and execution starts here. then whenever there is a return statement, the program counter will be replaced with the return address. So how it will find the return address? There comes our stack. So whenever a call to a subroutine takes place, after this call, what is the memory location? See, the call occupies 3 bytes. 1, 2, 3. It is a 3-byte instruction. So it occupies 3 memory locations. So after that, the next instruction should be found in the 4th place. So this memory address, okay, immediate after the immediate next instruction will be found in the next memory locations of this, and this will be pushed into the stack. Whenever there is a return statement from the subroutine, the topmost element will be popped, which is nothing but this 81H, and it will be placed in the program counter, and the execution continues. Again, here there is a call. See here, this subroutine is called 2 times, whereas it is written only 1. So the value, this will be calculated, whatever is said is done, and then the value will be whatever this parameter that will be returned to the main program. Now we'll see one more example. So this is a main program. These are the memory locations. Here we have a call to a subroutine. Now this goes a call to subroutine. This is the next memory location. Okay, after this call, this will be the next memory. This is only a pictorial representation. Whereas here we have seen, we have given it in terms of microprocessor 8085. So it is a 3-byte. So don't worry if it is 121. It is general description. So call to the subroutine. So after this, this is the next memory location. So what happened when a call to subroutine display, this value is pushed into the stack. This is the memory stack. So this 121 is pushed, this location is pushed into the stack, okay, top of the stack. Then the sequence, that is program control, goes to this one, whatever is what is the memory location of the subroutine starting, that will be placed in the program counter, and program counter starts executing the next lines. Then here inside the subroutine, there is another subroutine call. So in this case, what happens? This is the next memory location that will be pushed into the top of the stack. Now after 121, now 231 is pushed. Now calls up to, now it goes here, and then program counter value is replaced with this starting of the subroutine. So now it starts executing, and there will be a return statement here. When there is a return statement, it will go to the previous subroutine, that is the next to this call sub 2, which is, so where it will find this location, it will pop the value for that. In order to find the location, it will pop that value from the stack. So the popping takes place, and this will be placed in the program counter now. Now, you know, the program counter, whatever is in the program counter, that location will be the execution. That is how the microprocessor maintains the sequence of execution. So since this will be placed in the program counter, so after the return statement, it will go here and it start executing that. So one, there will be a return statement here also. So when it sees a return statement, already this has been popped, the stack pointer is pointing here now. Now this will be popped and placed in the program counter, and automatically the sequence starts, the program sequence comes here, control comes here, and execution starts. So this is how the sequential execution, even if there is a function, it properly is carried out by the any language. So two things need to be done when jumping from the invoking routine, say main, to the invoke routine, say sub. Push updated program content on a stack. That is what we are doing. When this is called, program counter is pointing this. So this value is pushed into the stack. Push updated program content on a stack. Then load PC with the starting address. Yes, after this is push, since this call subroutine, it is located in some memory location. So this memory location will be updated to the program counter. So load PC. PC is nothing but program counter with the starting address of the sub, the address of the first instruction, the sub. Then it keeps on executing. How it will return from the function? Pop the top of the item on the stack, the return address to the PC. Now this is what I have explained is general diagram. Now we'll see related with the microprocessor. So here this is a main program. Now this is a stack. Now call 14F0 is there. Okay, this is the main program. There is a call. So when there is a call, after this, this will be the next memory location. After this, this will be the next memory location, because 0FFD, after FFD, this will be, this is a 3-byte instruction. So if you calculate D, E, D is for this call, and 14 is for E, and F is for this F0. Okay, it occupies 3 memory locations. So after that, it becomes 100. This will be the next memory location. So what happens before transferring this sequence to here, this 100, the next, after this, what is the next memory location? This is the memory location that will be pushed into the memory stack. See here, first lower order, then the higher order is pushed, and the stack pointer is moved here. Now 14F0 is placed in the program counter. Now you know that program, the program sequence is maintained, and the it will always, microprocessor sees the next location to be executed from the program counter. So program counter will track, so always will have the next instruction to be executed. So now 14F0 is placed in the program counter. Now the control goes here, and 14F0, it starts executing, and then there is a return statement. But here what happens, here another call to another subroutine is there, that is nothing but this. So now when this is executed, now this value 15, the next instruction after this is, next instruction address is this. So this address is again pushed into the top of the stack. Now stack is moving upward, the pointer is now here. Now this 20FA is placed in program counter, and it start executing. When there is a return statement, what happens, the topmost element value is top 2. A return internally calls the pop operation, whereas a call will do push operation. Okay, so what it will push, it will push the program counter value. So this is the program counter value. So what happens, when there is a return statement, automatically pop, even if you don't explicitly use the pop instruction, it will be impliedly, it will call the pop instruction. Now it will be called, and the top 2 locations will be popped and placed in the program counter. Now program counter is the place where the next sequence is maintained, program execution is maintained. Now it comes here, the control comes here and start executing. Now there is a return, already this is pop, so stack pointer is pointing. Now return statement, when there is a return statement, I already told you, again a pop executes. So pop, these 2 values will be popped and placed in the program counter, and now it comes here, the control seek, the control comes here, and it start executing. So this is how any function or subroutines gets executed. So subroutines, 8085 microprocessor has 2 instructions for subroutines. Okay, how it gets executed, how it main do this subroutine execution. So exclusively there are 2 main instructions, one is call and another one is return. Call will make the control to go to the subroutine. Return from the subroutine to the main program, switching over is done. So call, after that it will be a 16-bit address to redirect program execution to the subroutine. It is a 3-byte instruction. Return, it is a single byte instruction. It return to the calling routine. Now we'll see how call instruction executes. So example, call some memory location. So what happens, it's a 3-byte instruction, and it is a 5 machine cycles and 18 T states. We will see why it is 5 machine cycles and 18 T states, because it do so many things. It just not switch, it will push the value into the stack, push the next instruction into the stack, all those things it do. So that is why it needs 5 machine cycles and 18 T states. So first push the address of the instruction immediately following the call onto the stack, and decrement the stack pointer register by 2. So all these things it do. So for that it need 2 machine cycles. So initially the stack pointer is here, and then when you execute a call, these 2 memory locations are decreased, and the program counter value, the next instruction after the call, what is the location of the next instruction, that will be now in the program counter, will point to the next instruction. So that information should be pushed into the stack. So let us have 200. This is a call. So after that, see there are 3 bytes are skipped. That is for this 2000. For call, it is 2000. Then 2001 is for this 40. 2002 is for this 00. And then the next instruction starts from 2003, as it is a 3-byte instruction. Okay, so this is the next memory location. That will be the program counter. When it is getting executed, program counter points to this. Now this is the value in this program counter. So when you give a call 400, this value is pushed first. Higher order bit is pushed, then the lower order bit is pushed. Okay, so this will be placed in the temporary register. This location is placed in the temporary location, because after pushing this only, the program counter will be replaced with this 40, this memory location. I already told you, using the program counter only, the sequence of execution starts. So once it is pushed, again the program counter has to be loaded with the memory location next to call. Then only the sequence goes to subroutine. So when it is pushing, this will be placed in temporary register called WEZ. So once this is over, this WEZ value will be replaced in the program counter. So jump unconditionally to memory location given next to call. Load the program counter with the 16-bit address supplied with the call instruction. This is what we have seen. So microprocessor reads the subroutine address from the next to memory location, okay, and stores a higher order 8-bit of the address in the W register, and stores a lower order 8-bit of the address in the Z register. Then return instruction. This is a single byte instruction, but it needs 3 machine cycles and 10 T states. Again, why? Because even if it is a single byte instruction, when a return is executed, it internally calls pop. So popping of 2 memory locations and placing it in the program counter. So it needs 10 T states. Okay, we will see how. Retrieve the return address from the top of the stack and increment the stack pointer register by 2. Load the program counter with the return address. That's what. So this is there, and it will be popped and replaced in the program counter. Then unconditionally returns from the subroutine. Now we'll see the exchange of information between the stack and the program counter. We'll take a small example. So this is the memory locations. So initially we are initializing the stack pointer to 2400. Okay. So 2400 stack pointer is pointing. Now 2040, after some times 2040, we have a call to a particular subroutine, that is 2070. So let us say this is a program starting address, and then at 2040 we have call. Then after this will be the next instruction, because this occupies 3 bytes. So this complete these 3 things together, call it as a 1 instruction. So the next instruction is starting here. So this 2043 will be placed in the program counter. Okay, so now after this execution 2042, it goes to the jumps to the 2070. After doing storing this value, pushing this value 2043 in the stack, okay, then it starts executing that up to 2070, 207F will be in the subroutine. There will be a return statement. Now it comes to the, after this, it has to come to 2043 in order for maintaining the sequence. So it will pop the value, a return will pop the value from the stack, and this memory locations will be replaced in the program counter from where it retains its sequence of execution. So this is where, here also we have given 2070 is the memory location where the first subroutine is there. So other subroutines are there. When there is a return statement, it correctly comes to this statement and start executing. Now we'll see the call execution. Here it requires, as I already told you, a call requires 5 machine cycles and 18 T states. We'll see how it is. It requires 5 machine cycles and 18 T states. Call instruction is fetched first. Call instruction. Here we have given the 5 machine cycles and what in each machine cycle it will do. Let's say 2040, here the previous example, 2040, we have this call, 2070 call. So 2040 machine equivalent is CD. This is the opcode. And then in 2041, we have the lower order, and 2042, we have the higher order. We have placed it like that. Then opcode, machine one is the opcode fetch. So at that time, CD will be fetched and it will paste on the database. So by the time, program counter will be pointing to the next memory location. So program counter has a 2041. And in address bus, this location will be there, because address bus, the current execution. So 2040, we have the current, and this will be fetched from the memory. Okay, fetched from this memory and placed in the database. Now, stack pointer is still having 23FF. That is what we have given. Okay, stack pointer. So here 2400 means it will be reduced to 1. Okay, 23FF. That's what given here. SP minus 1. Then in memory read, the next is a memory read. After reading CD, it will understand that two more read has to be done, because CD is a 3-byte. So the next will be a memory read. So in that case, the address bus will have the this memory location, and program counter is pointing to the next memory location, 2042. And now whatever is given in the address bus, that data will be read. So 70 is read and it is placed, and it will be placed in internal register. In EZ, it will be placed. Then in M3, memory read is done again, because it is a 3-byte instruction. So this will be carried over again. Stack pointer still it is there, because the whole thing is not read. So it waits for the whole instructions to be read. So 2042, that is, this will be placed in the address bus. Then program counter is incremented to 2043, which is the next instruction. Then 20, it will read this, and then it is kept in the W register. Then the fourth cycle will be writing the next memory location, next instruction memory location into the stack, that is pushing that value. So that is what being done here. So in M4, we have this, and here during M3 itself, what it will do is this, in this 2043, 20 will be written, PCH, that is program counter, higher order bit 20 is written. And during M5, this will be decremented and it become 23FE, and this 43 will be written in the PCL. Then at when this M5 is getting executed, it finally, it will be written into the, pushed into the stack. That's what done. Then this whatever is placed, 20FT, that will be replaced in that, that value will be placed in the, from this WEZ, that value will be placed in the address bus, which in turn, now address bus, it will be carried over to the program counter. So after 2070, it will be, next location will be taken from 2071, and the execution starts, because 2070, we have, this is starting address, so the next memory location 2071, and so on. Next, return. We'll see what happens in return. The program execution sequence is transferred to the memory location 2043H. Okay, that's what we have seen. So after 2042, main memory location is 2040. This has to be returned. When there is a return statement, it has to come to this location. We'll see that now. So M1 is normal fetch cycle. So this is a M1. At that time, this is the equivalent for RET, that is return statement. So 23FE, initially the stack pointer is pointing to 23FE, yes or no? So here FF, then FE, it has been decremented. Now 23FE, now it has to increment to 23FF and then 2400. Now during that, what happened? 23FE, the value 43, which is the top of the stack, that will be taken and it will be placed in the EZ register. Then in M3, again, the stack pointer is incremented, incremented FF to FE to FF, and then that value is the next higher order, higher order bits will be taken, and that will be placed in W. Then from this, it will be taken and placed, this will be placed in the program counter. In the address bus, in turn will be program counter. So the next location, next instruction, opcode fetch, from 2043, the values will be, whatever is said in that will be executed. By the time, the program counter will be pointing to 2044. So we'll see the rest in the next video.